going to talk a little bit loudly, and then Kamala does have a mic, so hopefully she will not need to talk loudly. Welcome to the annual Lynn Smith lecture. I'd like to welcome you on behalf of Asian Studies and Women's and Gender Studies. My name is Neera Sehgal. I'm the Director of Women's and Gender Studies. And today it's my great pleasure to introduce to you Kamala Bhasin. Kamala Bhasin is a social scientist by training, and she has been actively engaged in issues related to development, gender, education, media, and feminist rights since the 1970s. Currently, she is the founder of a feminist network called Sangha in South Asia, and she is also an advisor for Jagori, which is a women's resource and training center in New Delhi. And there's also a Jagori Rural, which works mainly in rural areas. She is the South Asia coordinator of 1 Billion Rising. It's a global campaign to end violence against women and girls. She's the co-chair of a worldwide network called Peace Women Across the Globe. She's also a member of South Asians for Human Rights. Before she did all of this, she worked for 27 years in the Food and Agriculture Organization in the United Nations. So her main work has been at the South Asia level, and she's been involved in various kinds of capacity building for young activists ranging from the age of 16 to 30 years. She holds gender sensitization workshops all over South Asia and other parts of the world. And she is also author, feminist author, and songwriter. Some of her really well-known books, one of her most famous ones is called Borders and Boundaries, Women in the Partition of India and Pakistan, which she co-wrote with Ritu Menon. And then some of her other books, which are out there, I'd like to highlight. One is called Understanding Gender. Here it is, What is Patriarchy? Exploring Masculinity, Feminism and Its Relevance in South Asia, which she co-wrote with a Pakistani feminist by the name of Nigat Saeed Khan. Recently, Kamala has written Many Notes, One Symphony, Understanding Pluralism. She's written a book for children called If Only Someone Had Broken the Silence. And one of my students came and told me today, she borrowed this book off of my shelf and she lent it to one of her friends, and she said, her friend said it resonated so deeply with her that she kept the book with her for a long time. I, of course, forgot about it completely. And today, in utter guilt, she came to me and she said, you know, I still have that book of yours. And I gave it to my friend, and it really meant a lot to her. And I'm like, just keep it. Just keep it. You know, it's just wonderful to hear that a booklet like If Only Someone Had Broken the Silence, which is about violence against girls and boys within families, if it means so much to you. She's also a humorist, so she's written Laughing Matters, which is a book of jokes, much circulated amongst feminists. And she's written a whole bunch of children's books, and this one is called Housework is Everybody's Work, Rhymes for Happy and Just Families. And Kamala, so these particular books, you should know, have been translated into 23 different South Asian languages. And they are used all over South Asia at the grassroots level to explain to people just simple concepts, as in what is patriarchy, what is gender, what is masculinity, just these things which seem super simple to us but are very difficult to translate into local languages and then have people really communicate these further to other people. And so I would like to have you all join me to welcome Kamala Bhasin and recognize that this is just such a wonderful opportunity. And she's come all the way from Delhi just for this talk.
Good evening. Namaste. Assalamu alaikum. I'm delighted to be here. A little nervous to be here. I'm always nervous in universities. As an activist, I said, oh God, what am I going to tell them? You know, they know it all. I wish to start my interaction with you by remembering, saluting, thanking all our foremothers and forefathers who fought for our women's freedom, who brought us here. I was reading some couple of years ago that in Harvard it took 238 years to give admission to the first girl, 238 years after boys were admitted. Oxford and Cambridge took longer, 270 years. So you know that struggles went into all the women coming and sitting here today as if it was our birthright. So I remember all of them. And speaking personally, friends, I owe a lot to both feminism and to the women's movement in South Asia and world and the world. For example, I owe all my creativity, all whatever I've written, the songs, the this, the that wouldn't have been there if feminism hadn't been there. I owe all my friends all over the world, like Meera, like Richa, and I have homes all over the world thanks to global sisterhood. And I owe my visit to Carlton to feminism, otherwise I wouldn't have been there. And I was delighted when I found that Carlton is where my niece lives with her partner and her two sons. So I'm grateful to them for looking after me for the first 4 days of my stay here and to get rid of my jet lag. Because of them that I am vertical and not vertical and not horizontal. So, I'm really going to be sharing with you what feminism means to us in South Asia. So, first of all, like all over the world, feminism for us is a response to patriarchy. Had there been no patriarchy, there would be no need for feminism. Patriarchy is this global system and a global ideology which believes men are superior to women. It's a belief. Men are superior to women, and in which men have more control over resources, decision making, and ideology. It exists as much in your country as in mine, in different ways. One feminist said that the first feminist must have been born the day patriarchy was created. Because patriarchy has different forms, for example, you in the USA do not have dowry deaths, so you don't work on it. We have dowry deaths, so we work on that. You have rape and we have rape, so both of us work on rape. So there are different forms of patriarchy, so then there are different forms of feminism. So feminism is not one, it's not a singular for us. Even in South Asia, we talk of feminisms. Feminism of a middle class, upper middle class, so-called upper caste woman like me, is by definition different to the feminism of a poor Indian woman, a Dalit woman, like here, white women's feminism, and then black women said, where are we in your feminism, women? So like that in India and South Asia, in Pakistan, it takes a different shape according to Pakistan. So I have always said and believed that feminism should really be like water. Fluid. Water is H2O everywhere. But it takes the shape of the container into which it is poured. Similarly, feminism has been largely, according to the local circumstances, it has to be contextual. it has to be local. And because in the local many things are common, like violence against women, like inadequate representation in the in our parliaments, you are still waiting for your first woman president. We've had them sort of long time ago, like 40 years ago. Not that it made too much difference, but anyway, we've had them. Because patriarchy keeps changing its forms, feminism has to keep changing its forms, its issues, its focus or foci. In South Asia, we were dealing with religious patriarchy, where religion was used to suppress women and to say all kinds of things about us. I mean, all over the world, religion has been on the side of patriarchy. For example, in the Christian tradition, Lady Eve was born from the spare rib of gentleman Adam. Like that, we have umpteen stories about how the second rib, the lower half, the weaker half was born. But today we deal with what I call capitalist patriarchy, which at times is much stronger today in South Asia than our religious and traditional patriarchies. Pornography today is a $1 billion industry. Cosmetics, which turn us women into objects, only bodies, we have no other thing which is important about us. It's a $1 billion industry. In South Asia, they sell something called fair and lovely. Even we in South Asia have to be fair. I mean, this is unfair, isn't it? I mean, we're supposed to be brown people. Why should we be fair? But the notion of beauty comes from the West. And you people come to India and other places and lie in the sun to get our color, and we spend all our lives rubbing creams on our bodies to get your color. I mean, that's what human beings are about. Toys are a $1 million industry with Barbie dolls for girls and Superman, Spider-Man, Sunman, all kinds of man for girls. And guns for girls. At the age of 2, he is given a gun. And then in your country, you see how every 2, 3, 4 weeks, a young man picks up a gun, goes to a mall, goes to a school, goes to a college, and kills 8, 10, 15 people. All this, according to me, is not because of their biology. It's not boys are born like that. Boys are made like that by patriarchy in your country and my country. And then we wonder when at 15 or 16 they are doing this killing, when they are joining terrorist organizations, when they are joining our oppressive states, whatever. So we have to constantly, as feminists, deal with all this. Now we have cybercrime. Make videos of girlfriends and then blackmail them by just putting them on WhatsApp and showing them. And girls then committing suicide. I mean, you know, so as feminists, we are constantly dealing with all this. So for me, feminism has to be fluid. It has to be contextual, it has to be local, and of course with links with the global. For us, some of us, feminism is only about gender inequality. So if you work on gender inequality, then you are a feminist. For some others, we say no, you can't work alone about gender inequality, because gender doesn't stand alone. It has close links to caste, to class, to race. In fact, at times I feel that gender inequality is required if you want race purity. You have to control your daughters and your sons, so patriarchy is necessary. If you want to keep class purity, if you want to keep particularly caste purity in South Asia, in India. So because gender is Now I come to the big word which we learned, intersectionality. So because of this intersectionality between gender, race, class, caste, etc., etc., for people like me, we can't just work for gender equality, we also have to work on all hierarchies. Hierarchies of caste, class, race, north, south, the first world continuing to dominate the other worlds. And this reminds me of a slogan of mine. I don't know whether in women's studies you just shout slogans, but I can't do anything without shouting slogans. Will you join me, like, in shouting a slogan with me? Will they allow this community? We need to close doors. All right. Okay. So I'm speaking your language. You have to now speak at least one word of my language, and that is called Azadi. Azadi means freedom. Okay, but you have to say Azadi. All right, you have to sit up with your spines. You can't win any struggle. So it's normally in Hindi, but I've been doing it in English for your benefit. We women want Azadi. You have to say we women want
Azadi.
That's right. Our daughters want
Azadi.
Your farmers want
Azadi.
The Dalits want
Azadi.
Come on. From sexploitation.
Azadi.
From rape and plunder.
Azadi.
From nuclear blunder.
Azadi.
From endless violence.
Azadi.
From helpless silence.
Azadi.
From patriarchy.
Azadi.
From all hierarchy.
Azadi.
For dancing madly.
Azadi.
For singing loudly.
Azadi.
For self-expression.
Azadi.
For celebration.
Azadi. Azadi.
We want it badly.
Azadi.
Don't say it loudly.
Azadi.
That's right. That's how it goes. So no talk can be given, at least by me in South Asia, without slogans in between. Because for us, feminism is not an intellectual exercise. We come for 3 month course here and a 3 month course there, and you get a certificate and you've got your feminist studies. For us, feminism is as much on the roads as in the classrooms. About 30 years ago, some of us got together and we said, okay, how do we define it for us? What is feminism? So we came up, who's a feminist, we said. So we came up with a very broad definition. Anyone who recognizes that women are discriminated against, where all? Within the family, at the place of work, and in society in general. So anyone who recognizes this and who takes action against this is a feminist. According to this definition, men are feminists. So in my definition, in my worldview, men are feminists. And in my opinion, the struggle for gender equality is not a fight between men and women. The struggle for gender equality is a fight between two ideologies, two ways of thinking, two mindsets. One says, patriarchy is better, this is what it has been, men are superior, and let's live with that. Otherwise, there will be anarchy. The other side says, no, equality is better. Everywhere, equality is better, within the family and outside. And on both sides, we have had women and men. There are women who are patriarchal, who are anti-other women, and there are men who have been supporters of gender equality. So we live with this broad definition in South Asia. Some people believe that any woman who is successful, who is strong, who has made a lot of money, who can say what she wants, is a feminist. And these are very important qualities: strength, articulation, money, innovation. But for me, one thing is missing in this. Is she against patriarchy or not? Is she for equality or not? So, if an Indian woman here becomes the head of Pepsi Cola, and she is the global head of Pepsi Cola, for me, she doesn't become a feminist. And also, I feel sad a woman selling Pepsi Cola, because we know 30% children here and in my country now, rich children, are obese thanks to these drinks. So for me, this aspect, am I against patriarchy? Am I hitting it somewhere? As a man, as a woman, as a girl, as a boy. That for me. So feminism for me is about values. It's about justice. It's about equality. For me, feminism is both a discourse, thinking, ideology. So I do fully respect the work you people do in colleges like this. It's important, this work which you do, but only if it is linked to action, according to me and according to us. If gender studies, which women's studies, gender studies, according to me, are daughters of the women's movement. It is the women's movement which produced women's studies and gender studies. Not to stand alone, but to help us with thinking, with ideology, because all of us can't do it. And that's why these small booklets, all these are question-answer based booklets, because we cannot read the books. Academics write, they write for each other. It's impossible, you know, for me to read one page of academic writing. I mean, it takes me forever, because it's God knows what kind of English you people write. I can't understand. You know, I've been to normal colleges, not schools. I went to village schools in Rajasthan. But I can't understand it, and I know that many others don't understand. So I tried to become a bridge between academic writing and grassroots level work by writing these very simple. I mean, I'm sure no other big book has been translated into 27 languages, because nobody understands it, even in English. But these are translated into 26, 27 languages. I do them in two languages, Hindi, Urdu, and English. And then they do it in whatever language. And for me, anyone can translate my books, because my definition of copyright is right to copy. I don't believe in this capitalist notion of intellectual property rights. I honestly believe we learn from all over. If we are breathing this air, we are getting ideas from all over. And then to put your stamp on it and say, this is mine, no one else can use it. This for me is a negation of what knowledge should be. Knowledge and love have to be spread free. And as you share them, they increase. They don't become less, unlike money, unlike property, unlike other things. The more you share, the more they become. So anyone can translate them and use them. So feminism for us is really walking on two legs. One leg of thinking, of academics, of research, and the other strong and firm leg of action. Only when they merge can we move forward. Even the activists can move forward much faster, much better, Otherwise, we do things blindly without knowing where we are going. And academics can have the finest theories but no legs. So, this is what we think. I am very happy that feminism doesn't have one or two mamas, like Marxism has Papa Marx, Gandhiism has Papa Gandhi, but feminism has no one mother or father or even 100 mothers. I mean, feminism has as many mothers, not many fathers. And I think it's wonderful that we have had the opportunity to say what we believe in. We don't have to copy someone from somewhere and constantly say, as he said in 1864, nothing doing. This creates problems because we speak in many languages then, many tongues. And we don't agree on everything. So, there are problems. But that is the reality. That 1,000 flowers bloom. So there are all kinds of feminists in South Asia fighting with each other, disagreeing with each other. And just to mention two issues on which feminism and women's movement is divided in the middle, globally I think, but definitely in South Asia, is one issue of reservation for women, affirmative action for women, and two on sex work versus prostitution. And I think globally, sort of we are divided on these two topics, and the debates are raging, sometimes not even pleasant. But if you can have so many varieties of Christianity and Islam and Hinduism and Marxism and socialism, we can have as many varieties of feminism. For us in South Asia, friends, violence against women and girls is a major issue. And I think globally also, at the moment, for the last 4 years, I am coordinating this global campaign called 1 Billion Rising, started by a sister from here, thought of by Eve Ensler, the woman who wrote the Vagina Monologues and who started V-Day. She'd been a friend since 2003. So she asked me if I would coordinate it in South Asia. I said, yes, I will, but I'll give you a firm answer after 2 days. And she called me after 2 days and I said, yes, two and a half conditions. She said, what are those? I said, there'll be no branding. We are not going to do it in South Asia in Eve Ensler's name or in the name of V-Day. We've been working on violence against women for 40, 50 years. So no branding. So immediately she says, Kamala, no branding, only granding. If there's no branding, you can really become grand, you can become big. It is this branding which makes you small. And secondly, I said it has to be democratic and it has to be decent. We will decide how to do it, what to say. She said, yes. So we've been doing it, 1 billion rising. Do you know what this 1 billion is about? Why 1 billion? No? Okay, I'll tell you. In the world, there are about 7 billion people. Half of them, fortunately or unfortunately, are we, women. Not going anywhere, we are here to stay. Out of these 3.5 billion, the United Nations says out of every 3 women, 1 woman faces violence. And in reality, in some of our countries, my country, it's definitely more than 1 in 3. It's closer to 1.5 out of 3, at least 50%. That means over 1 billion women and girls face violence in the world. No other war has ever affected 1 billion people. And what's worst about this war against women is that most of it takes place within the family or in intimate relationships. No other war takes place within the family or in intimate relationships. I'm told here there's been a talk of campus rapes, epidemic of campus rapes. Teachers and friends, colleagues who are supposed to be your friends, your guides, your mentors, sexually abusing you. And in this campaign, 1 billion Rising, the first slogan was, strike, dance, rise. So creativity, dance, music was part of this campaign. So we were not rising as victims. We are rising as survivors. We are rising, dancing, and singing, and postering, and all kinds of things, enjoy. That brought a lot of young people into this campaign. Because otherwise they say, oh, you're going to a feminist talk. They will do breast beaters, we are the official breast beaters, constantly beating our breasts and In this there is no There's dancing. So a lot of people have joined 1 billion Rising in over 205 countries is going on. And the main day is 14th February. 14th February, Saint Valentine's Day. The man who gave up his life as a young priest fighting for love. So on this day we are saying we don't want violence. We want love. We want to spread love. So our main slogan, coined by us, is not love of power, but power of love. Love of power is behind all violence. Whether it's a country saying, I want to decide, so I'll go and bomb Afghanistan, I'll go and bomb Iraq, I decide. And why should I talk if I have bombs? Similarly, a husband, why should I talk if I can use my hands and legs? So it's that love of power. And we want to replace it with the power of love. And that's what this campaign is doing, and it has brought a lot of energy into our feminism. Other than violence against women, you know, Meera asked me a question, what are the issues of feminism in South Asia? For South Asians and as globally, feminism is a perspective. It's not a list of issues. Every issue is a feminist issue. War is a feminist issue. Elections these days here is very much a feminist issue. Economics and politics are feminist issues. Technology is a feminist issue. So in South Asia also, capitalism is a feminist issue. Neoliberal globalization is a feminist issue. All of them affect women and men differently. So all these issues are vibrant in South Asia. These days in India, for example, the last week, we are celebrating a woman who has been fasting for 15 years. Her name is Erom Sharmila. In her part of the country, in northeastern India, there was a terrible rape case by the army. She was a young woman at that time, 16, 17. And there is a law in India for certain areas where there is unrest, political unrest. Armed Forces Special Powers Act. So if an army officer kills or rapes any number of people, there will be no punishment. Special powers of the army in that area. So she started fasting against this law and said, this law is draconian, this law must go. And after a month or so, she would have died, so the government picked her up, put her in a hospital, and started force feeding her through her nose. For 15 years, they have been force feeding her. She wouldn't eat. Can you imagine a woman or a man who, for a social cause, does not eat for 15 years, does not drink for 15 years? But finally, advised by many people, about a month ago, she decided to give up her fast because she feels these governments, they don't care for such things anymore. Gandhian symbols and Gandhian struggles for our brutal governments don't work. So she started now, first she's working on her body because she couldn't eat after 15 years. Her body wasn't used to it anymore. But she was in Delhi 3 days ago, talking about her plans now. And she's a simple woman, a poet, she writes. So she, so that's a big issue for us. And we are mobilizing globally, even through 1 million rising, to get signatures from all over the world to give to the President of India and say, please get rid of this Armed Forces Special Powers Act. In Pakistan, feminism was the first to challenge military dictators because they were bringing in Sharia laws which the women of Pakistan did not want. So in Pakistan we have had a very vibrant, small but vibrant women's movement, fearless women's movement, you know, much more than anywhere we can imagine. It was wonderful. In Sri Lanka, during the war in Sri Lanka, women have been involved with the issues of the Tamils. So really, feminism is always linking with all these struggles which are going on. In Bangladesh, in the last many years, we've been very closely working with the garment industry workers. You know, the factories from where the clothes come for you people to wear, they are such rotten factories that if it catches fire, 1,000 women will be dead inside. And they are paid what? $1 a day? $1.5 a day? And the last big fire was 2 years ago where several hundred women died. So this is a feminist issue for us. It's not just that domestic violence is a feminist issue. In Nepal, they were making a new constitution. So constitution making is a feminist issue. You are looking at every bit of the constitution. Our feminist women in the Constituent Assembly, Nepal, by the way, is the first country in Asia, maybe in the world, to give 33% reservation to women. It is the first country in our part of the world to recognize homosexuality and to make it possible for them to get married. So a lot is happening in South Asia in connection with the globe. She also asked me a question. Are people happy with feminism? The general public? I said, of course not. Why should they be happy with feminism when the feminists are not happy with them? I mean, tell me, what are the feminists happy with? We are unhappy with our religions because they are patriarchal. We have been unhappy with the academics and universities because they are patriarchal. We are unhappy with the economic system because it's patriarchal and anti-people. We are unhappy with the war industry. We are unhappy with the cosmetic industry. We are unhappy with media, Hollywood, Bollywood, all of them. We consider them bad. So if we are unhappy with them and we are hitting out at them all the time, so they use their strength to hit out at us all the time. So every time in India somebody hears the word feminism, they say, oh, bra burners. Can you imagine everybody in India had heard 30 years ago of bra burning, that all feminists do is to burn their bras. We have never heard about it, but they have all heard about it. This is how powerful the media are. And they didn't know who had done it. One woman here had done it sometimes. I don't even know the history of that. So we are all bra burners. So they have all kinds of names about us. One big thing about us, against us, is we are Western. Meaning we are copycats of America, American women. Feminism has nothing to do with India, in South Asia. So we are a transplant of American feminism. I mean, nothing more stupid can be said by anybody. People who say this are either totally ignorant of their own histories, or they suffer from a deep inferiority complex that every good idea has to come from America. I wish it did. Ha ha. Many bad ideas and bad things have come from here, you know, like Pepsi Cola, Coca Cola, Kentucky Fried Chicken, all that. So I share with them a story from Buddha's life 2,500 years ago to say that gender debates are pretty old in our countries. And this is written history. So Gautam Buddha started a new way of thinking on liberation, on moksha, on peace. And at that time in India, there was patriarchy, there were caste, and there was class. He was the son of a king, so there was class. He was upper caste, so there was caste. And there was patriarchy. After he got enlightenment, he declared that he will allow so-called lower caste people to join his sangha, his community. And my God, I mean, any religion allowing lower caste people is like allowing black people here. And this message spread like wildfire. And the message went to the women also. His aunt, who had brought him up, she got this bright idea. She said, oh, if this man is allowing lower caste people to join his sangha, then he will definitely allow women to join. So about 500 women gathered 2,500 years ago and walked to wherever the Buddha was at that time and came to the Buddha and said, sir, you are doing good work. The language is minor, don't worry now. You are doing excellent work. We are happy you are including the lower caste people. We women also want to be included. Buddha thought about it. He was an intelligent man. He looked at those 500 women. He said, my God, if they leave their homes and join my sangha, my religion will not last long. And then their toilets and their menstruation, and my God, who's going to bother? He said, no. These women didn't go. They went to Ananda, the first senior disciple of Buddha, and said, sir, your director sahab, ye kya baat hai, ye kya bol raha hai? What is Mr. Buddha saying? I mean, he's allowing low caste people, we who have given birth to him. He doesn't think we are good enough. So Ananda understood their logic. And he went back to the Buddha and said, sir, those women are not going back, and I think they're right. We need to discuss this. So Buddha said, okay, get all the senior monks to come and have a dialogue on this. They had a discussion. And 2,500 years ago, it was decided that women will be allowed into the sangha And of course, they made 8 rules, which made the senior-most Buddhist nun inferior to the junior-most Buddhist monk. This is the wonder of the penis. Wherever there is penis, there is superiority. There also, you know, this is how it works. So some people, because of these 8 rules, would say that what Buddha did was not feminist. But I believe that you can judge people only according to the context. What the Buddha did 2,500 years ago to allow women entry into Buddhism, that was such a big step. And was that debate between women and Ananda not a gender debate? Was that not a feminist debate? So we really don't have to import feminism from anywhere. Similarly, what Prophet Muhammad did 1400 years ago, and the rights he gave to women, which women did not have in that region, I mean, Islam was not there then. Women of that region had no rights. He gave them rights, yes, half that of men. But from zero to half, friends, what rights in actual facts, in actuality, has the UN given? Has it taken us from 0 to 50? No, it's a struggle. But he gave those rights, and it's unfortunate that today Islam has a bad name for being anti-women, whereas what Islam did for women, according to my understanding, 1400 years ago, was amazing. So, and where was the West at that time, 2,500 years ago? Where were the struggles here? And then I tell my Indian and South Asian people that even if feminism was Western, but it was a good idea, I would accept it. Because for me, ideas are not Eastern or Western. Ideas are either good or bad. If a Hindu from India gave an idea and it was as rotten as many of them floating around these days, the fascist Hindu parties, etc., those will not be my ideas. I will not accept that. Every good idea in the world, every good poem in the world is mine. And that's how I think. So feminism is not Western for us. And even if it was, for me, it would not be. Then of course they say all kinds of things about us, we feminists. We smoke. We drink. I mean, if an Indian man is drinking, we don't say India is drinking. When I drink, they say feminism is drinking. I mean, they use any excuse to call us names. And I don't blame them, and I'm ready to accept all these names. Because it is, after all, a political struggle for power. And if they feel they're losing it, they will shout at us. But I do tell young women that, listen, if you are not yet a feminist, please be very careful, think about it, and only then become a feminist. Because feminism is really, I mean, the most dangerous ism. I mean, once you are a feminist, you are the most boring person going. You can't enjoy 99% of jokes because they are about that. You cannot enjoy 95% Bollywood and Hollywood films. You will start questioning your darling husband. I mean, this is the only ism which enters our bedroom. No other ism enters our intimate relationships. It makes you question your father. Why is he giving all his property to the sons? Why Bush Senior, Bush Junior, Bush More Junior? Where are they? Kennedy Senior, Kennedy Junior, where are the daughters? Nowhere. All male hierarchies. We question all this. The first person feminism makes me question, the first person, is myself. How am I dressing up? What are my values? How am I behaving? And you know, it's awful to have to question yourself all the time, to question your mother and father and brother and husband and other women for the way they are dressing, for what they are doing. It's very awful. You know, I've suffered from feminism all my life. But on the other hand, I have nothing better to do, so I continue. And I enjoy. For me, and this is really just for me, feminism is like a spiritual journey. Like spirituality constantly encourages me to look at myself, to fight my weaknesses, my jealousies, my fears, my hunger for power. That's what this feminism does to me. And like spirituality, feminism is a journey and a goal, but who knows whether any one of us will get there. I don't know a perfect feminist anywhere in the world. It's a journey, especially if your or my feminism is also about class and race and caste. As a woman, it's easy for me to fight for gender equality. But am I fighting for class equality? Am I thinking of the rights of the maid servant at home? And I realize I'm not as passionate about that as I am about my rights. So as long as that is there, I'm still struggling to go ahead. And because this journey is going to be long, endless, I don't see it finishing in the next 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years, anywhere in the world, not even here, where you had democracy for 250 years, and still waiting for a woman president, and still fighting rape on campuses. I mean, anywhere else I understand, but rape on campus, where the most educated are supposed to be there. And I think lately, for the last 20 years, I'm working a lot with men, because I feel men haven't realized how dangerous patriarchy is for them, what patriarchy is doing to them. I find patriarchy is harming men at a deeper level than even women. I think patriarchy is dehumanizing men. A man who can beat his wife is dehumanized, is brutalized. A man who can rape a six-month-old girl or a classmate, he's lost it. He needs help. So I don't feel angry about these rapists. First of all, I feel responsible for them. If you give them a gun at three, what do you expect them to do? If this is how you teach them on the television all the time what sex is about, and the slangs which we use for sex and the words we use for women, that's how they are brought up. So today my feminism is about working with men, not to mother them at all, not to ask them to help us. No, we have helped ourselves till here. We have come far enough. Help yourselves. Form your own groups, like we did consciousness raising. You do it now and save yourselves. Otherwise, marriage and families will have no future. Our daughters in Carleton College are not educated to get husbands. The word husband, look it up in a good dictionary, means manager, domesticator. It means controller. You know that word, animal husbandry? It's the same word, husband. There you husband animals, here you husband women. In Hindi, the word husband is pati, means owner, lord and master. We don't want lords and masters anymore. We want life partners who work with us, who look after children, who know how to mother, not just to father, and women who know how to father. So for me, gender equality is basically the equality inside. Is the feminine and the masculine in each one of us in balance? So this is the journey, friends. This is what I've been doing, learning daily. Started in 1970, today is 2016, 46 years. I'm only 70 years old. So going on, thank you very much for listening. Competitions in the 70s in India. there were no beauty competitions. And no cosmetic, big cosmetic companies were bothered about them because India's economy was a closed economy. In the 1980s, Indian economy was open to the world, and only then Indian women became Miss Universe and Miss World. Before that, Indian women were not pretty because markets were closed. So this whole business has nothing to do with beauty, you know it and I know it. It has to do with business. And how come only sort of rich women come to these things? Are no poor Indian women beautiful, no poor African women beautiful? So this whole game is a game of money, is a game of, yeah, money. And my slogan is, women, make up your minds, not your bodies. So make up of the bodies for me is really not that important, making up our minds. Women don't make beds, make careers. I mean, those are the slogans we use. I think our beauty lies in our character, our beauty lies in our compassion, our beauty lies in our love. And our beauty does not lie in the length of our nose or the size of our breasts. That's where the beauty is. I like to dress up. Don't you think I'm dressed up nicely? Yeah, pretty good, no? I like beauty. I like beauty, but I like to define it myself. I like beauty which makes it possible for me to do other things as well. I like beauty which doesn't make me compete with people. I like beauty which doesn't make me undergo breast surgeries just to lift up my breasts. You know, it's my confidence which I need to lift up, and every lifting up of the breast. So here, for example, there's so much freedom. So people say, ah, we are free. I wonder, is it freedom to lift your breast by half an inch? What kind of freedom is that? Isn't that a complete colonization of the mind where I think that this is what my breast should look like? You know, I can go on trying that particular brand of soap which Aishwarya Rai, one of our actresses, uses. But if after 10 years, if I look into the mirror, I still look like myself. So what use is that? So this is how I think, this is what I talk about. But I find that the cosmetic industry, with all its money, is succeeding. And big money is being made even by Fair and Lovely. And now we have Fair and Handsome. Yeah. And very rich Indian actors like Shah Rukh Khan are promoting Fair and Handsome. So unless you are fair, you are not handsome. Okay. Thank you, Amanda. Yes, ladies, both of you together, what do you say? That'd be great.
Hi, I'm Abha. I'm wondering what your approach has been to more to feminism in religion, so say especially Hinduism, where so many day-to-day practices and traditions are favored towards men, and also attitudes on menstruation. And say if you do challenge it, people will be like, but this has been happening for decades, but the Vedas say this. And so how you have countered that in your daily work?
You see, religion, and every religion, I say, and really I don't know the theory of these things, that what I have understood with religions are, all existing religions are post-patriarchal. Before these, we had other religions where mother goddesses were worshipped and mother nature was worshipped. All of these religions are male-created, male-controlled, male-interpreted. None of them accept a woman to become its head. A woman can't become a pope, a Dalai Lama, a Shankaracharya, or anything. So they are totally patriarchal. And they, in Hinduism particularly, creates things like which make women impure, totally secondary, rotten. And we have shied away, women, feminists have shied away from challenging religion because it's not easy. But lately in India, the last 2 years, 3 years, women are challenging all temples which do not allow women to enter them. They are challenging mosques and dargahs which are not allowing women to enter. And I think today we need to decide which religious book, which book is more holy for us, our religious books or our constitution. For me, my constitution is holier than any religious book, because no religious books gives me equality as much as my constitution does. And my constitution has taken care of all the different religions, etc., etc. So for me, we need to choose today. And I challenge people in India that if you can't give freedom to women, write in your constitution that India doesn't believe in gender equality. India can't give equality to men and women. Write it there. So at least we don't get schizophrenic. We are getting schizophrenia. They're saying this, and then my father does Kanyadan. Abha should know what Kanyadan is. It's exactly what in Christian tradition, the giving away of the bride by the father. As if she's a thing going between the father and the bridegroom. The two are full human beings, and there's a transaction taking place. Kanyadan, donation of a daughter. And then the sindoor in our mom, and these menstrual taboos. So I tell them in India and Nepal, Nepal is particularly bad about menstruation and menstrual taboos. The 2016 educated women, educated here and going back and doing all this, you know, they can't enter the kitchen when they are menstruating. I was meeting a woman 2 days ago. I had dinner with her. She took me to Mini Ha Ha. I like the name. If it was longer, it would be better. Mini Ha 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 Ha. She was saying, and she is in Senfor, that when she was menstruating, she was not allowed to go to any part of the house where the rug was. The bloody rug would get polluted, as if, you know, our blood is running out of our vaginas and, you know, going on rugs. I mean, what the hell is it? And she says, in winter, if we were sitting somewhere, we had to sit on cold stone in Kathmandu, zero temperature. This is, and this blood, I mean, even the Pope came out of that blood, for God's sake. I mean, show me a man who can be born without that menstrual blood. And then for the same man to define it as impure. What is it? It's misogyny. It's hatred of women. It is putting us down. And we accepting it. For how much longer will we accept it? So, I mean, this is a big, big issue, and I've been speaking about it a lot. And in Hindi, I said, 1947, Bharat Azad nahi ho. Bharat Azad hua, Bharti Azad nahi ho. The men got freedom, women didn't get freedom. So, abha bahut lamba chal raha hai, tum bhi chalo mere saath wapis, tum kaam karo wapis. Ji.
Oh, I don't have a question.
You didn't have a question. Wonderful. So your hand was up too.
I was indicating that.
That is nice.
So here we're on the verge of a historic, possibly election. Well, historic in my government, actually. Possibly election first woman president. I'm wondering how you've seen in South Asia the impact. People like Indira Gandhi and Benazir Bhutto as sort of symbols for change, how it's affected people, as, especially young girls and young boys, being able to see role models in women, women in power, women in authority, how it sort of shaped feminism in South Asia over time.
Would you tell me your name?
My name is Jack.
Jai. Now Jai as a symbol is good. I hear stories from Pakistan when Benazir became the Prime Minister. Women in the bus would come walking as if they had become the Prime Minister. Benazir would say, move, move, Benazir is the Prime Minister now, let me sit. An illiterate woman. So yeah, at the level of symbols, these women are shy. But they didn't come there because they were feminists. They came there because democracy was weak in our countries, and we had to have either a daughter or a wife to lead a country. Can you imagine a big country where you can only think of a daughter or a wife? So women there had to wait for their daughter or, father or husband to die, and suddenly from the kitchen become prime ministers. So for me, these are symbols also of bad democracy, of a family-based democracy. And for me, I'm talking of feminists becoming prime ministers and presidents, not women. And you see the difference. A feminist should have certain values of equality. She should be coming there for bringing certain changes in gender, in class, in race, and other things. And most of the women in South Asia, and we have had many prime ministers, Indira Gandhi was not the first prime minister, it was Bandara Naike in Sri Lanka who was the first prime minister of the world. Why? Husband died. So the widow became the prime minister. You know, bad politics, bad democracy, equality. And all of them at this big level are either daughters or husbands, daughters or wives, and no contribution to feminism. I'm told one of the prime ministers of Bangladesh said, don't call me madam, call me sir, because for her, sir meant power. So really that doesn't help, and it is not biological women we are looking for. For that matter, this man, Mr. Trudeau, he's a pretty good feminist, you know. I mean, I choose him over many women who are not feminists. So, here, let's see what happens. The whole world is waiting for your election. That is very unfair that we have to listen to everything which happens here and we can't vote. Either we should not hear about it or we should be able to vote. Yeah, oh, you have a question now.
My name is Sarah, and you spoke about how you've done work with men and how patriarchy is just as harmful to them, or more so, you said, than women. I'm wondering how you go about those, or how you go about that. Like, what are things that you do? What do you do to work with men?
I think we really have to talk to people, dialogue. Show them what is happening to men. And you know, it's really the benefits men get from patriarchy are immense. UNDP did a survey to measure that if women all over the world were given a minimum wage for household work, how much would it be? In 1995, it was measured as $11 trillion annually. So they get this bloody $11 trillion free. All these men for whom we do all the work. And this doesn't include giving birth to children. Then 99% of the prime ministers and presidents are men. 95% of the Supreme Court judges, 95% of professors in many of our countries, etc., etc. So the benefits are immense. But 100% terrorists are men, criminals 95% plus are men, 100% rapists are men, traffic offenders more than 80% are men. I mean, on the other hand, just look at all this. And this is because of patriarchy, that you are a man, you can't cry, you are a man, you have to be this. You are... So one just talks to them about it. And you know, they spend all their lives making money, but some of them don't know in which class their children are. They have no time to take their child to their chest and lie with that child when the child has high fever. I mean, the basic, the deepest pleasures of life, which are connected to giving life, which are connected to closeness. I mean, they become like banks for their children. So they're okay. Daddy will give money, but daddy will not be available when I'm having problems. So basically talking to that and saying how much more beautiful it is to make a cup of tea for your wife or your mother, rather than to come there shouting and yelling, where is my cup of tea, and then you know, doesn't have enough sugar, and that kind of shouting, and saying that then your children will be afraid of you, they will love you. And what is life about? So just basically, talking is what I do. I don't even use PowerPoints. I say the power has to come from your eyes and my eyes rather than from these points. That's, you know, these are things. So just talk to them. And I do, most of my workshops now are with men, where they invite me. And I go and I sit with them for 2-3 days. I sit songs. I've written now many songs on masculinity and men, with humor, with fun. So we just do that. But I think before we go to men, we have to know, do we really accept them? Do we respect them, even for their weaknesses? Because one shouldn't go and try and teach anybody if you don't respect them. So that's, for me, the basic. And it is really worked. I've never had problems talking to them. If you talk to them as friends and not as men haters. But they do come with those fears. Oh my God, don't go feminist. She's going to eat me up. You know, like things like that. Thank you, Sarah. Yes.
My name is Apurva.
Apurva?
Yeah.
Ji Apurva.
Thank you so much for coming. It means so much.
For that, you have to thank Meera.
Coming from a culturally conservative Indian family, how can I challenge the patriarchy with my own family members, especially when I come from a family that's very ageist and my opinions are rather, and these are ideas I got from going to random liberal arts school in Minnesota.
Are they in India?
No, San Francisco area, but it's very high Indian population.
They haven't changed here?
My parents are pretty good, but some of my other parents.
I mean, first of all, you're sitting here far away from home, so they can't be as bad as you think. There's really nothing but discussion and dialogue and slowly. And the family sometimes is the most difficult to change. And some people, some feminists say that, oh, if you're not fighting your family, then what kind of a feminist you are? Personal is the political, it must begin at home. But at times it's extremely difficult for it to begin at home. So, I mean, you just have to find some allies, and if your parents are okay, then yeah, they are your allies. And there's really, dialogue is the only thing. What else can we do? And I am one of those feminists who's gentle, so I like relationships. I love my brothers, I love my father, I have problems with them. But we managed to change a few things. Many of the things like Raksha Bandhan in North India, where a sister ties a rakhi to a brother. And I thought about it and I said how stupid it is in my family, because my son is quadriplegic, he has cerebral palsy. And what would it mean if my daughter was tying a rakhi to him and he has to promise her protection? Whereas my daughter would be protecting him. So I said, okay, I love rakhi, I don't want to abolish this custom. Why don't the sisters tie rakhis to the brothers and brothers tie rakhis to the sisters? And today we women are pretty capable of looking after brothers and sisters and parents. So we'll have two protectors instead of one. So slowly changing these kinds of things, when my mother passed away, all the daughters came, whoever was in India, we did the last rites together. The priest came and said, ah, madam, they think as soon as you have short hair, you don't know Indian culture. If Indian culture seems to sit in our hair, so if you have long hair, you know it. So he says, madam, you see, Benji, women don't do last rites, so please go back. All I asked him, Panditji, do you want 500 rupees at the end of it? Or you don't? So 500 rupees was too big for him. So he said, yeah, okay, come do it. So that is how deep their religion is and their belief system now. So you can do a lot of things. And really nobody, literally nobody challenged me for doing that. There must have been some people who didn't like my participating in my last rites of my mother. But many old women and men came to me and said, that is good. We are so glad you did it. So sometimes it's not the others, it's our own fears. You know, and we just have to get rid of these fears. And if those traditions are any good for us, we should definitely follow them. But if those traditions are good for nobody, then why the hell are we following them? You know, we have given up everything, we have come to another country, we are speaking another language, and we are doing those things which are putting down women and girls. Don't accept. Reject gently. Gently. Gently is important. Hana? Apurva. What's your mother tongue?
Kannada.
I don't know. I'm an illiterate in South India. Ji.
My name is
Zina. Zina. Zina, Baba. Baba, what a nice name. Zenith means beauty. Aha, kya baat hai?
So I'm curious about how you deal with women who have been raised with the mentality that talking about violence at home and with partners is frowned upon. And it's very much sort of thing you talk about in public to against your family and things like that. So what are sort of the things that you do with women to either get them to talk about it or prove to them that it's okay to
which background are you from? Ajeeb will be able to do it.
Pakistan.
That's not. I'm Pakistan. Ah, very bad. 46 May, I was born in Punjab, Pakistan. In Lahore. I'm from Bahia Gaon, Chota Gaon. Shahida Wali. Beautiful name. Shahida Wali. Listen, if the family is all you have, and you have nobody else to protect you outside, then it was a good thing to say, don't talk about violence outside. Because who's going to protect you? So I feel we talk about violence outside, but we in India and South Asia have not created, and in Pakistan, have not created alternative families. We have not created alternative homes, shelter homes, etc., etc. So we need to do that as well. And then the women will come and talk outside. But why talk outside? If the outside offers you no solutions, we can just give slogans and lectures. Plus, gradually, not just through lectures, but through legislation, through some implementation, through some legal support in Pakistan and in India and other countries. Now women are coming and talking, and in fact there is a debate whether rape has increased in India and Pakistan, or is it that reporting has increased? And I think maybe both is happening. So there's nothing else except feminist solidarity. Organizations like Asma Jahangir and her sister have created, or in Karachi, war against rape. So one has to just create alternative families where she feels they can protect me against my husband, because her own parents might not. So where should she go? So I think if I was in their position, I would also not go and talk outside, because if outside offers me no support, then what to do? So one really needs to. And my slogan, by the way, that Azadi Tum Thi Ho, Toh Tumhe Wahi Se Seekh Ke Aayi Ho, Haan Lahore Mein Maine Seekha. So that slogan which I sang with you, that is from Pakistani women who taught me that, and now it's global, going everywhere, even arrived in Carlton today. Yes, it is 7 o'clock.
Okay, I think we should stop. If people want to talk to Kamla on an individual level, you can come up and talk over here. Kamla is also coming to 2 of our classes. If anybody wants to join in those classes, there's Amna Khaled's class tomorrow at 1:50, Women in South Asia. And she's coming to my Gender Power in the Pursuit of Knowledge on Thursday at and both classes are in late. So with that, thank you all for coming and thank you for that.